Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Flip-Flop Operating Characteristics and Applications. Before we begin this lecture, what I want you to do is try this seemingly innocuous problem and don't spend too much time on it. If you pause this lecture and try to do this thing, you will realize that there's some problems with this. It doesn't look terribly hard. It looks like a D flip-flop. It's got some clock input and it's got some D input, and I'm giving you the initial conditions Q. And why is it so hard? Okay, the reason why it's so hard, it's this, a negative edge detection device. Look at your first negative edge. Okay, your negative edge is occurring right on top of that transition of D. This negative edge is occurring right on top of that transition of D, and same thing here. What is it at that transition time? And the answer is, I don't know. It could be a 1, it could be a 0, it could be an invalid logical level. It's illustrating an example is you can't do things like this because there's this concept of setup time and hold time. So these devices have limits that you can't ask them to do things like this because there is this concept of setup time. The input has to be there a little bit before the clock edge. Okay, that's what setup time is. Hold time, that input has to be there a little bit after the clock edge. It's like taking a picture of a four-year-old with an ice cream cone. You're not going to get the picture because they don't move around very slowly. Setup time. Let me draw two diagrams here real quick to illustrate what I'm talking about for setup time and hold time. So here's an example of a negative clock edge. We're zooming really, really, really in on these things here, by the way, too. At the negative clock edge, what that TS is the setup time. If you really want a 1 sampled at that negative edge, what you need to basically say is that 1 has to be there at least 1 setup time prior to the clock edge. Okay, so when you look at a data sheet, for example, like the 7476, which is a negative edge triggered JK flip-flop, or actually this is a D flip-flop example, but anyways, you can find that setup time. Additionally, that 1 has to be there at least a hold time after that for that 1 to be reliably read into that. Does that transition from 0 to 1 on Q occur instantaneously? The answer is no. Okay, there is propagation delays that you can look up on a data sheet too. So that is a propagation delay from the clock edge with respect to a synchronous input. Okay, and that is a pulse transition from low to high propagation. I could also easily have a propagation delay high to low from a synchronous input, or vice versa from those asynchronous inputs like presets and clears, because they may have different propagation delays. Let's say if I suddenly clear out the whole thing right here at this moment, one would think it would instantly respond. The answer is no. There is a finite measurable propagation delay before the device completely responds. So setup time, the time prior to a clock edge getting there, hold time, the time after the clock edge getting there, it's got to have that there. That four-year-old's got to hold still for 1 second so you can take that picture of them eating that ice cream. Okay, that's kind of the concept. However, these propagation delays is the transition of the output. There's a measurable delay that occurs. Hand in hand with all the setup time and hold time and propagation delays is the maximum clocking frequency. I mean, if you were running this thing nuke and fast, where another negative edge occurs right there and another negative edge occurs right there, it's not going to work. Those pulse widths of that clock definitely related to the frequency. You've got to go ahead and make sure that they are operating within those ranges of the setup time the whole time and giving a chance for that propagation delay to occur. So there's a certain maximum clocking frequency that you can run these sequential devices at. Let's talk about applications. There are a number of sequential logic applications. The major ones are here. Okay, so the major latch and flip-flop applications, which we'll be covering a little bit later here. Again, this is just a brief introduction. I'm not expecting you to remember every single detail about these things, but what I do want you to understand, these are some of the applications that we're going to be using. Obviously, first and foremost, memory. Okay, we've talked about over and over, we can store information in there. What is a register? It's a group of latches or flip-flops that are set up to store a number. Let's say we want to store your score on the last quiz, a 9 out of 100. What are you going to do? It's a 4-bit number. Use 4 registers. And what we're going to do is I'll say the bottom one is the MSB, the top one is the LSB. What we're going to do is we're going to put 9 1001 on the inputs. But before we do that, maybe it would be a good idea to clear everything. So what we're going to do is going to take all those clear inputs and tie them all together and send a zero on that. Clears everything out. Go ahead, put a one back on that. All those presets have a one on there. So there's basically this whole register device has a preset. Whole register device has a clear. And then what we're going to do is we're going to tie all those clocks together. And then positive edge on that clock comes along. What happens is 1001 is stored inside that register. What's the next application? It's a counter. Think about just counting 1, 2, 3. Kind of, you have to remember where you're at. It would not be a good counter if you constantly forgot where you're at. So you have to remember your prior state. That's kind of an application for a sequential device. So think about this circuit here. Okay, so what if I was to take two negative edge JK flip-flops and hook them in the following fashion, and what I'm going to call the one on the left is my low order, the one on the right is my high order. The low order has a designation of Q0. The high order has a designation of Q1. What is the clock input for the high order? Well, check it out. It's the output for the low order. Okay, now what would happen if I put the high order constantly in toggle mode and the low order in constantly a toggle mode? What I've created here is what's known as an asynchronous or a ripple counter. Just think of in terms of Q0, right? Okay, let's say Q0 was a zero. If it was a zero and every negative clock edge, and I've drawn the clock up top here, it will toggle because again, we've got constantly in toggle mode. It was a zero, now it's a one. It was a one, now it's a zero, and toggle, toggle. Now, from the perspective of the high order JK flip-flop, who is also in toggle mode, what's happening with it? It's taking its inputs off the negative edges Q0, or the negative edges of Q0 right there. And let's pretend it was zero. So it stays zero and then toggles again. Again, what have I created? I've created a ripple counter. Check it out. If my high order is my MSB, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Sounds like I've created, in this particular case, a 2-bit binary counter. Want to create a 3-bit binary counter? Use a third JK flip-flop hooked up in this fashion. Problem is remember propagation delay. Okay, if there's a propagation delay for Q0 to respond to those synchronous inputs, stands to conjecture it's going to take a little bit of time to get through there. And then Q1's going to take a little bit of time to get through there. It's going to ripple through there. So we're going to get some undesirable circumstances. Obviously, a true 2-bit counter should count directly from 00 to 01 to 10 to 11. But in the case of an asynchronous ripple counter, what we'll get is these potential glitch states where we are not truly counting in the proper sequence we want. How do we get rid of that? Is this thing called a synchronous counter. Don't worry about the synchronous counter right now, but just understand the difference between an asynchronous and synchronous is as such. Synchronous, they all count simultaneously. They all have the clock signal together. I'll show you how to do that. Basically, the long and short of that is they're all clocked together, and you kind of trick the inputs for J and K to potentially set, reset, or toggle, or stay the same based upon those clock inputs. Directly related to a counter is this thing called a finite state machine. There's two types, a Moore and a Mealy machine. Okay, so counters, they go from 0 to 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, or they can count down 9 to 8 to 7, whatever. A finite state machine is kind of like a counter. However, it doesn't have to count in the sequence. I know that sounds kind of weird right now. Why would you have a counter that doesn't count in sequence? Well, the reason why is because there are states that you can make decisions upon. Okay, we'll go into this a little bit later, but what's really neat about that is you can take those states and potentially decode them to provide output. Let's say the classic example is the traffic signal in pretty much every digital electronics textbook I've ever seen is there are states that you can output to a decoder, which will have output to these devices, and is basing its next state off its present state and some external input. That's a Mealy machine. Finite state machine, it's kind of like a counter, but it can go to different states within that sequence. It doesn't constantly have to do that next state, next state, next state. Okay, frequency divider. This is something you may have not have seen before. And it's just a real quick example here is I've already kind of drawn a frequency divider. Look at the clock signal on this diagram with respect to that of the Q0 out. Okay, is the clock a faster frequency or a slower frequency? Well, the answer is the clock is a faster frequency and Q0 is a slower frequency. Okay, I'm slowing something down by putting it into in this particular case, a JK flip-flop. Okay, how does it relate? I mean, think about that. Here is the period of the clock signal. What is the period of the Q0 signal? Well, it's twice as much because it takes two full clock cycles. What is the period of Q1 with relation to that of Q0? Well, it takes two of Q0's periods for one of its own. Get the picture? It takes four clock signals for one of its own. I'm slowing down a particular frequency, okay? Because I could have potentially a 50 megahertz oscillator on my FPGA development board. Maybe I want it to go slower. Basically, what I'm going to do is put this thing into a frequency divider and potentially get a 60 hertz signal or a 200 hertz signal, whatever signal I want from that 500 or that from that original 50 megahertz. We will go into these applications a little bit in depth, but I do want you to understand that what is the sequential device used for, the SR latches and the flip-flops that we've discussed thus far. They're used for storage, registers, memory, counters. They could be asynchronous or synchronous. Finite state machine is kind of like a counter, but with a lot more cool stuff with it. And finally, a frequency divider. Let's move on into describing some of these flip-flops and latches using VHDL.